simply didn't make because it sounded good. I think when you sit in the Situation Room and listen to the commanders in chief tell you that this is a huge recruiting tool for Al-Qaeda, that our indefinite detention of people like that who shouted to the news cameras is actually used to recruit the next wave of terrorists. Look, I think the hardest thing is not going to be the 84 or 86 that might be transferred through Saudi Arabia's program or into Yemen or even back into places like the United Kingdom, but what to do with those 46, that to me...
Forever prisoners.
Right, because the truth is the biggest impediment in closing Guantanamo is not those that can be transferred to Yemen, it is... What do you then do with those 46? Do you send them to a wing of the Supermax facility in Florence, Colorado, in which the warden has said he's never been to hell, but he's pretty sure that prison's worse than hell.
Right.
You know, they're not going to build, they're not going to take over the facility in Illinois or Standish in Michigan. The question is, you know, how do you get the Congress to lift the prohibition to bring some amount of those prisoners, some level of those 46, into the continental United States for indefinite detention? That's the hurdle.
And let's keep in mind, John, I mean, there is movement on the Senate side to transfer some of these guys out. It is costing us $3 million per detainee. This is fiscally wildly unsound, to say nothing of the foreign policy thorniness of it. And yet, we were talking about this during the break, the notion that the House would do anything to assist the president or those who would like to see Guantanamo Bay be closed, it is another unicorn on the Capitol Hill.
It is. I mean, even in the Senate, frankly, you know, the ad is obvious. You know, so-and-so voted to bring terrorists to the United States. Bang. Nobody wants that. Democrats and Republicans both. Even if they support closing Guantanamo, even if they don't think this is just or cost-effective, they don't want to see that ad run on them. And I think that kind of bald political reality is what's going to keep this thing from moving.
I just think that there's some other part of reality, which is we cannot and should not, as Americans, be jailing people indefinitely who have committed no crimes. Like, that is not what this country stands for.
No, there's clearly a strong moral, legal, and political reason to close Guantanamo Bay and to sort out what to do with the prisoners. You're right, Robert, that when Guantanamo was first set up, it was a huge recruiting tool. Mm-hmm. I wonder 12 years later whether it is still as potent a recruiting tool. I don't know what the intelligence is saying on that. I'd be interested to know. It seems to have kind of, the damage to the United States was done when this was set up and when it wasn't closed back in 2008 when the president said
it. The last time I had access to that, there was no doubt that it was a recruiting tool, and I have no doubt that somebody has taken that CBS clip, made a YouTube video, and is circulating that in places like Yemen and Pakistan right now.
Carol, before we go, speaking of that, the recidivism rate among Gitmo detainees, according to the New America Foundation, is confirmed at 4.7% and suspected at 4% and suspected at 4.7%. 8.7 overall is not great, but it's also, you know, I don't know where one comes down as far as what is too high. Your optimism in terms of next steps and anything changing down in Gitmo?
It really doesn't feel like it's about to close anytime soon. And as much as the messaging overseas may be bad, there's some in Congress who like the message that Guantanamo sends to the world, which is mess with us and you end up at Guantanamo Bay. So there isn't any unanimity, that this thing is about to close.
Carol Rosenberg of the Miami Herald, thank you. And thanks for the great reporting.
Thank you.